Hello, everybody. I'm Father Robert Spitzer. I want to welcome you to the Napa Institute. Of course, I'm not welcoming you the way I normally do as the MC today. This is just my talk on suffering, which we thought might be an appropriate talk, given the fact that many people have really been physically and fiscally harmed by this COVID-19, the social unrest around us. And so the topic today is, how do we deal with suffering through our faith? How do we deal with suffering through the grace of Christ, the Holy Spirit, that's so abundant among us? I'm going to talk about 5 points very briefly, but you'll be able to get these PowerPoints later on, the ones that are on the screen. And also you can go to magiscenter.com and you can get whole articles on the topics that I'm speaking on. Just go to magiscenter.com, click on the happiness and suffering landing page, and you can get articles on all of these topics. I'm going to be talking about 5 ways of really making suffering count, really getting the most out of our suffering through our faith. Number one, we're going to talk about the resurrection perspective. Number two, some spontaneous prayers to say right in the middle of suffering. And number three, talk about controlling fear and anxiety during suffering. And then four, what are the opportunities of suffering? What's the Holy Spirit trying to do through us? And then finally, number five, how do we follow the Holy Spirit in times of suffering? Okay, let me just proceed to the first point, which is the resurrection perspective. We're all people of faith here at the Napa Institute, so I'm assuming that you have this perspective. But boy, it is so necessary when you are suffering. So necessary to know that where we're heading is the resurrection. Not to be living for this life, not to be living for some aspect of this life, not to be living for, you know, some thing that we think we have to have during this life. The main thing is, we're living for eternity, and this life is a blip on the radar screen. Yes, it's important, but at the same time, we've just got to be so convinced that what God has planned for us, what Jesus told us would be, our risen life, our salvific life, is really true. I'm just going to mention 3 points because there's much to be said on these points, but there is a huge amount of new historical evidence for Jesus's resurrection. And that's all on the magiscenter.com. If you just go there, you can get a whole article. I can't explain it today. The second thing is the wonderful studies that have been done on near-death experiences. And if you just click on our first landing page on faith and science, the main thing to remember is that you can see, first of all, there is tremendous peer-reviewed medical studies of near-death experiences that I think show very conclusively that not only are you going to survive bodily death, your consciousness is going to survive bodily death, but when your consciousness does survive, and by the way, there's tons of veridical evidence for this, when it does survive, you're going to go to the other side. You're going to meet deceased relatives and friends. You're going to be greeted by a loving white light. All suffering will be gone. You will know that God and Jesus are greeting you. The evidence is really quite amazing, overwhelming. The third area is the Shroud of Turin. Again, if you could just go to the second landing page, it's there, which is on the historicity of Jesus. And take a look at that. There's a whole section on the Shroud of Turin that's there. There's also on the first landing page about faith and science, you can see this. But the main point is there is really excellent evidence to show that in order to make that particular image that's on the Shroud of Turin, you would need at least around 6 billion watts of light energy emitting from every three-dimensional point on the dead body that was inside that shroud. Now, dead bodies don't normally do this, and so I think you can pretty much say this is a supernatural occurrence. It's a miraculous occurrence whereby you've got basically, somewhere in the neighborhood of 500,000 searchlights worth of light energy emerging for 1/40 billionth of a second from every three-dimensional point on that body while the cloth is actually penetrating into the body or the body is moving through the cloth, either one. But you can be sure that This really is, I think, a resurrection light, a resurrection in glory, a resurrection power that's really emblazoned on the Shroud of Turin, 2,000 years ago. So all the evidence is there on the Magis Center website. Just go to it. Be convinced. Know that as suffering happens, we're living for eternity. Don't doubt for a moment. Jesus has prepared the way for us in the resurrection. You can count on it. And as they say, I'm certainly putting my whole stake in the ground for this. And I think you can count on it. Don't live for today. Don't live for this world. Live for the eternity of resurrection and glory and power given to us by Christ Jesus our Lord. Let's go to the second perspective. So when suffering strikes, right, the first thing we got to do is bring the grace of God into our suffering. The best way to do this is short, memorable, what we call spontaneous prayers. Easy to remember. You repeat them several times. They start becoming the conduit of grace that starts working in your life when suffering is hitting you. I'm just going to give you some examples of this. As I said, they're all on the screen there for you, and you can get these spontaneous prayers by just clicking, going to the Magis Center and clicking on the Happiness and Suffering landing page, the third landing page. Let's go through the first one. Help! That's always a good prayer in times of suffering. The second, of course, you've got the resurrection perspective here. You're certain of it. The one prayer you want to remember is, Lord Jesus, I place my trust in you. Just keep repeating, Lord Jesus, I place my trust in you. And you'll see that eventually that grace is going to start coming into you. You're going to be able to let go into God's hands. Let's take that third prayer, so important. Hail Mary, full of grace. Of course, this is a prayer of consolation. This is allowing, our mother, the mother of Jesus Christ, who is the mother of God, just allowing her into our lives. She's crowned with glory. She has been assumed into heaven. She's present and interceding for us. She'll bring us consolation as well during our times of suffering. Let's take a fourth prayer we just want to remember in times of suffering. And this is really the kind of prayer that is so important, when we're conceiving of the opportunities of suffering. Lord, make some good come out of this suffering. Make some good come out of it for me, for my salvation. Make some good come out of it for others, if I'm an example for others, or helping others to get to their salvation. Give me the wisdom to help them, to come to salvation. Lord, make some good come out of this, for the kingdom of God. Whatever you do, just lever this suffering for the greatest imaginable opportunity. It's a great prayer. Let's go to the next prayer. Of course, everybody knows this. I certainly knew it from my mother, heard it 100 times. Offer it up, she would say. And indeed, we should offer it up, because we can offer up particular sufferings for particular people right in the moment that the suffering occurs. Just say, Lord, I offer this suffering up to you. I join my suffering that I'm experiencing now to yours, Lord Jesus, and you, Father, you, Lord Jesus, you, Holy Spirit, just make that suffering, good for this person. Help this person who I know has a drug problem. Help this person who's just, sick right now and needs some help, etc. We can just offer it up to them. Just join your suffering to Christ's suffering and just keep using that grace to give to others. The next prayer that really is important is, I give up. You take care of it. We're not in control. And when suffering's really acute, we're really not in control. So the one thing we really want to remember is just give it over to God and repeat that. Lord, I give up. You take care of it. And he does take care of it. It's just amazing. I've got so many stories to tell you about how this prayer just made pressure come right out of my ears. I was just able to, sort of getting a sense of what's really important. But just give it into God's hands. You're not giving up on life. You're giving your suffering into the Lord's hands, letting him take care of it. And he does take care of it. you know, the next prayer, this is an important one for those of you who feel that foreboding on the horizon. Sometimes you feel that depression coming on. Sometimes you feel, you know, anger and anxiety that's coming on. And you just, you know, it's just like, oh my gosh, how much more can I take? The foreboding's here, you know. You know, half the time it's the evil spirit just trying to stoke up your fears, stoke up your anxieties. Here's the prayer I use. I use my hands too. I just say, Lord, push back the foreboding. And I just keep repeating it. Lord, push back the foreboding. Push back the depression. Push back the darkness. Push back the darkness. And as I keep saying that again and again and again, I'm telling you, the darkness, the depression, the foreboding starts to subside. Just keep repeating it until it does subside. And you will see some fantastic results. Another prayer which is really important when I've done something wrong, right? In other words, when I've, you know, said something, or I was snapping or done something, I just always use this prayer, especially if I wake up at 3 o'clock in the morning and I figure out how serious, you know, my little, you know, rejoinder or my snapping or my temper might have been. I just say, Lord, make some good come out of the harm I might have caused. And I just kind of repeat that again. That's the best part about these spontaneous prayers. Lord, make some good come out of the harm I might have caused. And then finally, when somebody has done something awful to you, it's just bothering you, right? You know you need to forgive them. You know you have to pray for your enemies, right? And so forth. So the main thing is, Lord, this is my prayer. Lord, you're the just judge. You take care of it. Lord, you're the just judge. You take care of it. And I just give it all to him. It's amazing how I can pray for that person or take care of that situation, you know, or, which has been so unjustly done to me. I just give it over to God's hands and I tell him, you take care of it. I put it in his hands. I let it go. The anxiety begins to subside. What's the most important prayer of all that I say 20 times a day? Thy loving will be done. Just remember this. The Lord's will for you is that, right, is that he's going to work through your suffering to bring optimal good, optimal salvation, and optimal justice, optimal love. He's going to bring that out of every instance of suffering. So what prayer should you repeat again and again? Lord, thy loving will be done. Lord, thy loving will be done, because his will is loving. It's going to optimize good, optimize love, optimize salvation, optimize justice in every single solitary situation. Now you take those prayers and just start trying to commit them to memory if you could. And just, you can get them, right? You go to the third landing page on the Magis Center website. You go to magiscenter.com, go to the third landing page, happiness and suffering, and just click on those getting started on prayers, those spontaneous prayers. They're all there, and you can also get these PowerPoints from the Napa Institute. Let's go to the next area, the third area of how to suffer well, and that's controlling fear and anxiety. This is very important indeed, because of course fear can sort of get overwhelming. But the first thing to do to control fear and anxiety is to pray those spontaneous prayers. Bring the grace of the Lord into the picture. After you've prayed the spontaneous prayers, after the grace is starting to take effect in your heart, the next thing to do, of course, is to start being smart. Start reflecting. Start thinking. Why? Because the moment you start thinking practically or even thinking abstractly, you know what happens? It takes your mind off of fears and anxiety. It takes your mind off of the feelings, the negative feelings. So my thought is, get prudent, get thinking, start rationally. And how do you start rationally thinking? You ask yourself some questions. Here's four questions to ask yourself. Again, you can get you'll get the PowerPoints, you'll get the questions. Just remember them, just bring them forward. Number one, what's the worst thing that could happen to me? Just even, you know, picture. Okay, so let's suppose everything does go wrong. Everything collapses, worst thing happens. How do I manage it through the grace of God? How do I manage it through the grace of God? Now, 99% of the time, the worst case scenario isn't going to happen. Why do I point that out is the first question. Just get it off your mind. Don't dwell on it. Just look at it and say, okay, what's the worst that can happen? This is the worst that can happen. Instead of just feeling fear about it, start thinking, how would I even manage that? Now then go to the second question. Second question is, okay, what are my backup plans? I figure the worst scenario isn't going to happen. It really doesn't happen 99% of the time. But the main thing is, okay, so what's backup plan number one? What's backup plan number two? So just get some backup plans that are not the worst possible scenario. Start kind of crafting them out for yourself. But notice, you're thinking and thinking and thinking. And as you're thinking, you're not feeling anxiety and fear. You're trying to actually manage this. It's a really important step. Third question to ask yourself, who can help me get to these backup plans? So I've got these backup plans out there. Who can help me? Start making a list of people who can really help. People who might want to help. People who you don't know if they might want to help or not, but they might want to help. And so you just put down the names of the people who really might be able to help you, join in with you, get you to your backup plan number one. If that doesn't work, get the backup plan number two. Who can help you? And last but not least, once you've resolved on some people, once you've resolved on a backup plan, the last thing to do is, what are the steps I need to put on my calendar? Remember, if you don't get it on the calendar, it doesn't exist. So you got to get it on the calendar. When you do get it on the calendar, what are the little starting steps I need to take? What do I have to do to put it on the calendar? Notice that as you're doing all this good practical work to manage your suffering, and remember, what we're trying to do is manage. That's how you keep, you know, fear and anxiety under control. Don't think about solutions, ultimate solutions. Lord, just get me out of here, flailing your arms. Don't do that. Instead, be utterly rational. How am I going to manage it? Who is going to help me to do this? What are the first steps to get to? And it takes your mind off of the fear, the anxiety, so important. Okay, let's get to the fourth step, really important as well. What are the opportunities of suffering? How does God use suffering? How does He lever it? How does He use suffering to get us to our salvation? That's the main thing that's really important right now. So first thing that we need to do is take a look at, well, what does Jesus tell us? What does the scripture tell us? First thing is, boy, suffering can really shock us out of a superficial life. Let's suppose we just decide, well, I gave my life over to, I'm just going to live for more money or more pleasure, level one, level two, ego comparative. I'm going to be the top of the game, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So I'm going to put, a level one, level two, emphasis on my life. Or suppose even I was really taking a destructive path. I mean, I was doing things, I was getting into kind of darkness or sinfulness. I know this is a Napa Institute, people don't get into that, but might know somebody who is getting into that. You might have a grandchild that you might know, is having these problems. And so I'd say, keep all these PowerPoints, just give them the instructions on how to suffer well, because if they are taking a dark path or a sinful path or one where the devil's kind of got them by the neck, it doesn't just have to be something superficial where I'm putting all my time and investment into level one and level two. The point is, right, the first thing to ask the Lord is, okay, Lord, I want to get off this path. So if that suffering happens and you're just going, oh man, what is this all about? Just ask yourself, again, a question. Am I on a superficial path? Have I put too much investment into ego comparative stuff? Have I put too much investment into money or just level one or, pleasure or, the status that comes from others or being popular, being powerful, being controlling, et cetera? Have I done that? I mean, I know probably the question of, am I on a sinful path? Am I on a dark path? Is the devil controlling? Probably not going to affect people the Napa Institute. But the main thing for you to remember is, ask those first set of questions just in case, because anybody, Jesuits, priests, anybody, right, saints, look at the life of St. Ignatius and St. Augustine, I rest my case, St. Paul, I rest my case, right? There's plenty of times when the Lord actually gets us off a dark path, gets us onto the right path. Okay, the second question that we need to add, so the second opportunity of suffering, that oftentimes occurs is that there's something out there for us to grow in faith. And so the main thing to remember is that we can actually, when we are in trouble, when we are in need, what do we do right away? As St. Paul tells us, we turn to God. and we let God into our lives in ways that we never let him in before. We're vulnerable. We're asking a question. Lord, how do I deepen my faith? How do I deepen my trust? And God is leading me through the suffering to deepen my trust. That's why St. Paul tells us that, you know, as I grow weaker, Christ grows stronger within me. I'm trusting more in him. So look for the opportunities to deepen our faith, deepen our trust in the Lord, to give things over to him. Don't worry. You're going to get these little life lessons where you're going to find, you know, that the Lord is actually leading you through these things. And so it's going to be, I think, a splendid process. You say, oh, it was a painful process. I'd rather avoid it. Yes, I'd rather avoid being blind myself. But as a matter of fact, God has surely strengthened my faith and my trust, and he's given me the hints on how to do it. So the third thing that's really important as well, and this is truly an important point, is you know, humility. You know, pride can be the death of us all. And it was the one thing that St. Paul feared more than anything else in the whole wide world. And so when he feared those things, you know, what did he say? You know, the Lord gave me an angel of Satan to beat me, to keep me from getting proud. I asked three times that he should take this suffering away from me, but he saw fit not to do so, right? In other words, what can possibly be worse than suffering? Being so proud and so self-sufficient and so distant from the Lord that, you know, so, you know, messianic, so, you know, believing in ourselves that we actually don't even know our need for God, don't even know God's love for us, don't even know God's presence for us, right? So St. Paul tells us, okay, you can deepen your faith through suffering and you're trusting God through suffering, but you can also detach from pride. You can detach from the world. You can detach from the things that are actually, you know, destroying us. And that suffering will make us grow weaker. And as we grow weaker, Christ grows stronger within us. The faith life grows stronger within us. And that makes all the difference. The fourth area, you know, that certainly has been the case in my life. I mean, going blind has been so wonderful in so many ways. But one of the great ways is, you know, suffering always gives us that noble, that opportunity, excuse me, to do something noble, something self-sacrificial for God. So I just decided, hey, okay, I'm going blind. Can I help out other people who are going blind? By the way, I think St. Paul was going blind. I think that was his thorn in the flesh, the angel of Satan, to beat him, to keep him from getting proud. But my point that I think is really important is, okay, you've got this thing. You can offer it up, right, for somebody else who is really in need if you can't see an opportunity. Or you might be able to say, I can help other young blind people. I can go on, you know, to these sites and talk about, you know, being president of Gonzaga University while I'm going blind. Or I can now, I'm completely blind. I can talk about, hey, look, you know, you can still do all kinds of things like Napa Institute videos. And you can do Magis Institute videos. And you can do them as blind as you want. People will help you out. You've got a lot to offer. People with suffering who know how to suffer well have a lot to offer. And I can just say that we have so many people that we have interviewed and talked to who have just levered their suffering to the max for the benefit of others. Another really important opportunity of suffering is it builds empathy for others who are suffering. It builds compassion for others who are suffering. And I can tell you, you know, being Mr. Self-Sufficient who didn't want to have anything, you know, I was very impatient with people who, oh, you didn't get that math equation. You know, I'm sorry, first time around, you know, and the impatience would come over me. Boy, I'll tell you, going blind, I suddenly need people's help right and left just to get through an airport. Boy, does that not only give you a little bit of humility, but boy, you empathize with all the people who you just sort of bypass. You ignored, you didn't even notice, or you got impatient with. It really opens you up. And just ask the Lord to lever that suffering for all that he can give you. Last but not least, you know, the opportunity, of course, in offering up your suffering to the Lord is just join your sufferings to the sufferings of Jesus and start directing that, right? Every ounce of my blindness, every ounce of getting worse, everything, I just took it all and I just said, okay, Lord, it's yours. I give it to you, offer it up to you, but please help this person, this person, this person in my family, and peace, help these people who have already passed from this life to the next. And I just made a ministry out of offering up my suffering. And I know when I get to heaven, I'm just going to sit back. I'm going to go, whew, thank you, Lord, for all that suffering. It helped me get into heaven. It opened up my heart to other people. It gave me the opportunity for noble self-sacrifice. It opened me up in faith ever more deeply to you. And of course, it shocked me out of my superficiality, my impatience, and my stupidities, and actually got me to doing my examine prayer in a way that I should have done it. And at the same time, I offered it up for all these people. And I'll get to say hi to when I get to heaven, and you know, when they get to heaven. And so we'll be in a community of love. And so that's my point. There's tons of opportunities in suffering. Remember, it's all towards heaven. It's all towards helping other people to get to heaven. One final point, the fifth point about suffering well, and that is to follow the Holy Spirit in times of suffering. I know I'm giving you a lot of stuff, but there's whole articles on this on the Magis Center website. You can get the PowerPoints, you can review them, look at this thing another time. But here it is, just how do we follow the Holy Spirit in times of suffering? You know, point number one, when one door slams, the Holy Spirit is opening up, you know, another door, another two doors, another three doors. I'm not kidding you. The Holy Spirit's already trying to get opportunities open for you, not only to suffer well, not only to, you know, to relieve your suffering partially, but most importantly, to get you to heaven and to help you get other people into heaven. Your ministry of using your suffering, your weakness to get other people into heaven. And so the main thing is just look for the opportunities in suffering. Point number two, when that happens, you'll find another open door. You'll find another opportunity. Something's going to reveal itself. And you might even say, eh, that's not for me. I'm not the type of guy who does this. And you want to almost ignore that opportunity. But here's what's going to happen to you. You're going to feel something drawing you, a fascination, an energy, something that's, you know, kind of drawing you through the door, almost as if it's saying, come on, you know, and it's the Holy Spirit. I'm not kidding you. He's sort of, you know, 90% of the time it's the Holy Spirit saying, come on, you can just come through the door. I'm telling you, this is the opportunity for you. You might not have thought you had a teaching career, Spitzer, but look. So one of my great sufferings when I was in college, and I got led right to teaching others, and I discovered a whole dimension of myself, and it turned out, yeah, God was inviting me through that door. Third thing to do, when you see that new opportunity develop, ask yourself, okay, you know, I've got this new opportunity, but I've got family obligations, I've got work obligations. I can't put my family obligation, my work obligations at risk, but can I manage this new opportunity that's coming out of my suffering? Can I manage those new opportunities and still maintain my responsibilities to my family first, my work second? Can I do that responsibly? If the answer is yes, keep going through the door. And as you keep going through that door to seize that opportunity, there's only one step left. And that one step is that you gotta test the spirits. Just make sure that as you are following that opportunity that's come through your suffering, right? Just make sure there's an increase in trust in God in your life. So that's faith, trust in God. Make sure that you've got the opportunity of hope in your salvation. Okay, so you want to hope in your salvation, and that you're growing in hope in your salvation, and that you're growing in love, so that, you know, eventually your heart is opening up. You find more empathy for others, deeper faith for others, right? And so you can see yourself growing, you know, in patience. You see yourself growing in kindness. You see, you know, 1 Corinthians 13, love is patient, love is kind, love is merciful, does not grow angry, doesn't, is not boastful, etc. so you see yourself growing in love. If you're growing in faith, hope, and love, just keep running through that door. It's the Holy Spirit leading you and helping you to lead others into the kingdom of heaven. If, on the other hand, you notice a decrease in trust in God, so you feel like, oh gosh, you know, God's going to, well, he's just indifferent to me, or he wants to send me to hell. That's not God. That's the evil spirit telling you that. Stop that right away. Or if you see yourself decreasing in hope, right? Instead of hoping in your salvation, you suddenly think, oh my gosh, you know, the odds are I'm going to go to hell, you know. And finally, of course, if you see that you're getting more impatient, more unkind, more unmerciful, etc., more angry, more boastful, something is amiss. And so, of course, you know, be careful. You might have to modify your opportunity, or you may have to abandon it altogether, because it may not be the Lord leading you, but the evil spirit. But most of the time, it's the Lord leading you. And those are the five steps for suffering well. Remember that you can always go to magiscenter.com, and you can always click on that third landing page called Happiness and Suffering and get all the articles that are written on the 5 points on suffering well. You can also get these PowerPoints from the Napa Institute. Please, please, please share them with your children, your grandchildren, your friends. I'm Father Robert Spitzer. And again, welcome to the Napa Institute. This is the Lord's plan for us in order to suffer well and bring us into his kingdom with all the other people that we have helped. God bless you.